worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Friends, sati does not mean mindfulness, since mind is not full of manifold various objects. In awareness, it is rather stilled into a precise, unique, calm, one-pointed focus. Sati is thus much better translated as awareness or presence, which is one of the five spiritual abilities and powers, one of the seven factors of enlightenment, and the seventh method of the Noble Eightfold Way, and in the widest sense, a factor associated with all advantageous, lofty, and beautiful kinds of consciousness. It is established by the core early Buddhist method called Satipatthana, the ground or the foundation or the basis of awareness. The function of right awareness and its associate is knowing right and wrong awareness, as right and wrong awareness is right view. Exchanging wrong awareness with right awareness is right effort. Right awareness has the function of observing, noticing, remembering, and knowing the true reality that neither any body, nor any form, nor any feeling, nor any mentality, nor any phenomena, nor any mental state is real, lasting happiness or truly attractive or satisfying or something to be kept. It is not even personal. This awareness knows that all phenomena are momentary. They pass away right after the moment of their arising and occurrence. Nothing is permanent. Everything is in a state of flux, arising and ceasing, emerging and vanishing, coming and going, again and again and again and again and ever again. This impermanence, this change is called anicca, the second universal characteristic or sign of all samsaric existence, tilakana. Continuously seeing this transience, this dissatisfactoriness, this impersonality is right awareness. Samasati. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 98, recorded mid-April 2018 under the cypress tree after a heavy rain couple of days just by the cypress hermitage in central hill country Sri Lanka. There are three questions and one work report, but as usual, first the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the Blessed Buddha. Excuse me, I just have to remove a small blood-sucking leech that is buzzing around somewhere here. Ah, never mind. Let it eat its mouthful. Remember to click subscribe there and click the small bell there. If you have already clicked subscribed, it is your ticket to Nirvana. And click like if you like. And here comes a small work report right here. See friends, yesterday we made the last pillar inside here. We've been repairing the kuti because the pillars that were standing here up here was 130 years old iron bars from a tea factory from colonial time, and they were rusted through low. So now we have cemented them up in two times. First we made the lower part, and then we had only one box, then we made the higher part. And you can see also there, lower part and higher part, two times. So it took a couple of weeks for each pillar. And then we have made a cement wall with drain holes towards the tropical rain. And now it will be painted and there will be tiles. And that's the last box we made yesterday. So now the Bhavana kuti is safeguarded, and we can start on doing the meditation hall work. There's still some sand left, so we start to make the pillars here also the same way. I think we'll have to use the box three times, because they have to be 10 feet high, these pillars. And there is 12 pillars times 3, so it's 36 times we have to mix. And see this beautiful tree over here that is flowering like a mat. That's yellow, huh? I would say fairly yellow, at least. And there's tons of them. The bees are very happy. And so am I. Have a nice day, and thank you. Then to the questions. Question 291. We are crawling towards 300 questions. I'm happy about it. There are several questions circling about Buddhahood. Why does a Buddha have to be a male and not female? Yeah, I cannot really say why, because I don't know exactly why. But what I can say is that it doesn't go only for Buddhas. It goes for all the kings on the higher levels. Sakya on the king of the 33, Mara on higher up, Mahabrahma even higher up, and so forth. However, one loses one's gender at the Brahma level, that is from level 12 and upwards. They have no gender. They're neither male nor female. And they can take up any form. I would say that usually these questions is asked by females who have a dream about becoming a Buddha themselves. And the first answer is that is possible. Why so? Because a female can become a male. And thereby go through the cycle of forming the Bodhisattva woe in front of another Buddha. I will give the circumstances that are necessary in order to do that right after here. But cannot do it as a female. However, females can enlighten. And this means that they can reach Nibbana, lasting happiness, deathlessness. And that's actually the crucial point. Usually these questions, I got it before, is ask out of envy, I have to say. And this is usually the case that the females envy the privileges of the male. In this case, the privilege or exclude or exclusive state of having the option of becoming a Sammasambuddha. But they should remember the important thing regarding lasting happiness and deathlessness and Nibbana is available for all human beings, but not for the animals. So you can say Buddhahood, Sammasambuddhahood, not enlightenment, but Sammasambuddhahood is not available for the devas either, at whatever level they are, whether male or female, nor is it for lower beings as humans. They cannot even enlighten. So there's no reason to be envious or have any inferiority complex towards this issue of that it's only males that can be Buddhas, Sammasambuddhas. All beings, all human beings can have the potential to awaken if they strive for it, whether male or female. Another thing worth mentioning is that it is not only female that envy males, it is also poor that envy rich, those with a low education that envy those with a high education, those in undeveloped countries envy those in developed countries, the ugly envy the beautiful, the low envy the high, and so forth. However, unfortunately and very tragically, and it also goes for the female male envy case, this is not the way to get what you want. This is the opposite way, then you're going backwards. The Buddha said to a female who wished to become a male that it was possible she should honor the male gender. And those males among her who were honorable. And then she should do good and form the wish, ah, for this good I do towards the Sangha, for example, inviting the Sangha for dana, for a meal. Then she should dedicate this merit to becoming a male in a future rebirth. And actually there is a case of a very, very famous, very, very dedicated female devotee that formed this wish. And the Buddha asked her, she's invited the Sangha for 7 days. The Buddha came with 700 monks, and for 7 days she cooked herself. She was a high-class lady. She cooked herself and made all the preparations herself. And at the end of the meal, he asked her for what purpose she has gained this merit, this probability. And then she went close to him and kind of privately in between these two told him that it was in order to become a male, in order to later become a Sammasambuddha. And then the Buddha smiled, because that's a very, 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 very good, if not supreme, wish for a Buddhist female devotee to do this particular thing in order to become a Sammasambuddha, because it's a hard thing to become a Sammasambuddha. They have to go through innumerable rebirths even after they are able to enlighten. And this brings me to the Bodhisattva vow that Buddha Gautama did for Asankhya's, for incalculable period and 100,000 eons ago. And that he could become enlightened, but he delayed his own enlightenment for the sake of us. And we should be very grateful for that. And numerous others, Sammasambuddhas have done that for us. He made 24 of them. And the first one was Dipankara, which you see pictures of here, where he put himself down in the mud so Dipankara could win over him as a bridge. One Asankhya, they asked the Buddha, how long time is one Asankhya? Yes, he said, you take a box of 16 kilometers high, 16 kilometers wide, and 16 kilometers deep, and fill it up with sesame seed, which is approximately 1 millimeter, but less than 1 cubic millimeter. And then when you fill it up with sesame seed, then each sesame seed represent one kalpa, one eon, one universal cycle, which is approximately 150 billion years. So it is an immense period. Buddha Gautama, he went by intelligence. He had only had to go four asankhyas. Then there's somebody who goes by faith, they have to go eight asankhyas. And then there's somebody who goes by energy, enthusiasm, which is the case of the next Buddha, Maitreya Buddha, and they go 16 asankhyas, incalculable periods. That is a box of 16 times 16 kilometers wide, deep and high, filled with sesame seed, times the number of sesame seeds, times 150 billion years. So the Buddha said about Maitreya that he have seen 10,000 Buddhas. So the Bodhisattva role, this particular male then do is, he has to be a human being, fulfill these eight demands, he has to be a human being, a male, sufficiently developed to become an arahant in that very rebirth. He should be a recluse at the time of the declaration of the Bodhisattva role. He should declare his resolve before another Sammasambuddha in order to it to be effective. He should possess of the attainments such as the jhanas and the superpowers. Sumedha, which was the name of the Gautama Buddha at that time, came flying through the air and was dressed up in bark cloth, and the bark rustled when he was flying through the air. When he saw the road, people were putting flowers at cleaning as Dipankara were coming along. He should be prepared to sacrifice all, even life, and his resolution should be absolutely firm and unwavering. So you can see the special kinds of individuals. Then he sat down consider which perfection should I now perfect. The 10 mental perfection, the Dasaparami, which is generosity, the first one, Dana, morality, Sila, withdrawal, Nekkamma, understanding, comprehension, Panya, enthusiasm, energy, Virya, Kanti, tolerance, endurance, patience, Satya, truthfulness, honesty, Adhitana, determination, resolution, Metta, friendliness, goodwill, and Upekka, equanimity, indifference, imperturbability. And this he finds out right there, after having given his Bodhisattva role, which then is repeated for each Buddha he then meet. And for each Buddha he then, Buddha Gautama met 24 other Buddhas, and in each case they predicted that he will be a Sammasambuddha in a future rebirth, named Gautama, his horse will be Kantaka, and so forth. His wife's name will be Yasodhara, and so forth. They tell him what will happen, how it will come about. Then he should be intending or bending towards or be inclined towards withdrawal, seclusion, non-greed, non-hate, non-ignorance, and be intending, inclined towards, only going towards escape, that is the disentanglement, the opposite of involvement, the opposite of engagement. So he should be bent towards, inclined towards this escape. Then he should make the five great sacrifices, giving up wife, children, kingdom, life, and limb, like organs. Huh? Then he should have the perform the three kinds of conduct, charya, natata charya, striving, ever striving to help, lokata charya, ever striving to save the entire world. Difficult job, huh? See, look at the world today, how would you do it? And Buddha Attatacharya, striving for Buddhahood. Then they can strive for these 4 to 16 asankhyas and 100,000 eons or kalpas. 4 to 16 incalculable periods of a box of at least 16 times 16 times 16 kilometers filled with sesame seed, where each sesame seed represent 150 billion years. On the Bodhisattva and the Buddha, see the two links I give below on whatbuddhasaid.net in the library and a Buddhist dictionary over Pali technical terms. There's one on Bodhisattva and one on Buddha, explaining the details. Question two from this, I assume, is a lady. Does not that imply discrimination against women on the spiritual path? No, again, since animals and devas and whatever level of gender, they cannot attain Buddhahood, then I think there's no discrimination. And it's just a matter of conditioning. Why can devas, not that are higher than humans, have higher abilities than humans, higher degrees of freedom of humans, why cannot they not attain Samasam Buddhahood? Because at that level, the luxury, the refinement, the aesthetics is too good, too pleasurable, too enjoyable to see suffering, and thereby come to see the Four Noble Truths, to realize the Four Noble Truths, which is synonymous, the same as Nibbana, the same as enlightenment, the same as process of awakening, is to see, realize, comprehend fully and irreversibly forever hereafter the truth of this is suffering, the truth of craving is the cause of suffering, the truth of absence of craving is the end of suffering, and the very truth of that there is the Noble Eightfold Way, that is a method to end suffering. Realizing that is enlightenment, and that you cannot do if you are at a higher level than human, because then everything is perfumed and there's a tinkling music in the trees and you have 216 lovers. Very difficult, huh? Two, are all Buddhas destined to take birth in India only? If yes, why so? Yes, it is. That's the case. They all enlighten at Bodh Gaya. The explanation that is in the commentaries is the following. It is said that Bodh Gaya is the navel of the earth, and it is only Bodh Gaya that can sustain the weight of a Samasambuddha. I have long pondered upon what this means actually, and to be honest, I don't really know what this weight means, whether they have a special weight. I don't think it's in kilos, but it could be in probability, for example, the amount of probability, the amount of consciousness they carry could be the reason why they do not come other places. It is said that there is four fixed spots on planet Earth, where all the Buddhas, they always come. It's the exact seat under the Bodhi tree in Bodh Gaya at the Mahabodhi temple, which you see here. This Bodhi Palanga. This is the same Buddha after Buddha after Buddha after Buddha after Buddha. The tree is not the same. Neither is it the same sea species. Then the deer park at Isipatana, where the first sermon is preached, sitting, rolling in the wheel of Dhamma, the Four Noble Truths. This is also the same. Then the spot puts his foot down after he has been preaching the Abhidhamma to his mother at the Tavahimsa heaven. Then he comes down at Sankasa and puts his foot a particular place. That's the same for all the Buddhas. And then the four posts where his bed stands in Jetavana, in the perfumed gandha-kuti in Jetavana monastery, is also the same. So there is a regularity there. It is a bit like Dante's Divine Comedy, that this conditioning between mind and matter, it keeps repeating itself. Beings are born and become greedy and jealous and what have you, and they this form, this divine, this conditioning of all these interactions between all these nodes of consciousness of beings at various levels forms this divine comedies. But it's a different actor that is playing a different role each time. So it's only after enlightenment that the actor pass out of the game of being caught up in various roles in this divine comedy called samsara, which is actually very tragic because it entails an endless row of rebirth, aging, sickness and death. Have you reached, next question, have you reached any of the four stages of enlightenment? I cannot answer this question because why? Because monks are not allowed to discuss any supramundane matters with lay people. And this goes for all monks and all supramundane. So we can discuss it with other monks and lay people can declare their state. But I cannot declare my state, so I cannot answer this question. Question four, is there any being born as human who has not committed wrong or evil acts in this life or in previous life? Categorically, no. There's no beings who has not committed evil acts either in this life or in a prior life. I would say maybe Bodhisattvas don't commit any in their last life. But even that, I'm not exactly sure about, because they come down here as anagamis, and anagamis are not enlightened yet. So anagamis can still do something that is not exactly perfect. But all beings, including bodhisattvas, has numerous accumulations of evil acts. So one should not be ashamed about it, nor deny it. Just see it as it is, that one did this and that evil, this and that bad, this and that wrong, that one has to suffer now, from now and in the future, as long as one not purify this mind that keeps doing this wrong, this evil. Why is wrong doing it? Deep down, because of ignorance of the Four Noble Truths, because of greed, favoritism, because of hate, opposition, because of envy, because of fear, because of mental defilement, basically. That's why the being do this evil, that they will come back again and have to suffer the consequences of, due to the law of karma, which works as a probabilistic mirror that reflects the intentional, the ethical quality of the intention back into the neck of the mind, the defiled mind that did that in the past. One should feel great compassion towards all beings that are not enlightened yet, because blinded and obstructed by this ignorance, dragged forward like a ring in the nose, bound by greed, desire, lust, pushed, inflamed and burned by hate, anger, irritation and aversion, and deceived, seduced by self-deception, belief in an ego, in a me, I am this and that, I'm male, I'm female, I'm high, I'm low, I'm human, I'm Buddhist, just to take a few, self-deception of the most common kind. Huh? I am. No, there's no I that am anything. That's a defiled mind. That's a cluster of clinging to form, feeling, perception, mental construction and consciousness. These are five processes that are ever changing, never the same, never was, never will be. One can put a label on it, but that's only a label. It's a drifting thing, unfortunately often drifting down and not up. We're trying to bend this process of drifting upwards right here, right now. Good luck with it. So much for these four questions. Question 292. Why does the mind become negative? Because of bad past karma flooding the mind as a probability wave from behind. So here, right now, in this, for example, at the point of my finger, is an electromagnetic wave field consisting of multiple frequencies of undulation of electromagnetic waves. Some carriers radiate information from the plane, from the ships, and a lot from internet and mobile telephones and so on. So the information density on the tip of my finger is enormous, in fact infinite. This is one field. There's another field of gravity also here, obviously. Then there's a field of light, otherwise you couldn't see me. That's also electromagnetic radiation. So there's many frequencies here. Each color of light has its own frequency. So there's many frequencies, wavelength, either going very quickly up and down or going very slowly up and down. Radio waves, long wave radio waves, has a wavelength of kilometers. And a visible light has a wavelength of approximately 1/1000th of a millimeter in the nanometer range. Right? Similar thing with consciousness, that also has a wave aspect. It forms undulations, then thereby plants and embeds information, intentional information in space that is non-local, everywhere present. And that one is walking around. When one walks into such a wave of probability one has set going, let's say 10 lives ago, then one will experience what information is embedded in this wave, just like receiving a telephone call. When one is hit by a wave from the nearest mast of a telephone call calling your number, it's all the same frequency, because otherwise the phones wouldn't work, but they have a code, huh? So the phone is continuously looking for the tower, and it will only ring if it receives a code from the tower embedded in this wave, 4.1 megahertz wave. Digital information, small undulations of up and down on this carrier wave, then it will ring. Similar here, one is going into a wave and thereby having a phase relation with it, being exactly at the same wave top at that. So it's two waves that has the exact same, at that particular time point in space, the top of the wave exactly at the same point. Then one will experience whatever that wave contains of one's own past information, because it is mind is frequency specific, just like mobile phones are. Mobile phones cannot take long wave radio or FM or television information. Same thing with mind. Probabilistic waves measure probability, not electromagnetic undulation, but waves of probability. Then the information they embed are therefore events, phenomena. So this means that phenomena are also, you can, in quantum mechanics you will call it observations or a measurement. In Buddhism you will call it an experience. So a mind having a bad feeling, feeling sad, sorrow, unsatisfied, even in luxurious circumstances, like in a hotel with five beautiful lovers and any meal at the end of your fingertip, then it can still be dissatisfied, frustrated, because of this wave hitting it from behind, of some karma it did in the past that was either tainted by ignorance, greed or hate, or all of them. And that's why it feels bad. And that's why it's so important to purify this behavior, this intention, this chetana, because it forms these probability waves that beams out probably with more than the speed of light, but just like say the speed of light, and they will stand out there as undulation in space-time and undulate until one absorbs them at a later time point. So they are not dampening by anybody else. I cannot experience your karma, I cannot absorb your frequency, nor can you absorb my radiation of karma. So it's strictly individual. Strictly individual. That's why what is the best way to overcome sloth and torpor, laziness and lethargy? First of all, I'd say laziness is like a prison, we say. And this is because you cannot do anything. You're from inside bereft of activity, being able to do something. being able to do what you want, being able to do what is needed, being able to make progress, being able to do anything whatsoever, than just lying on the sofa, flipping the video game or television zapper while eating unhealthy foods. Lethargy and laziness, sloth and torpor, ruins any life, any life. So it's usually seen as some kind of innocent, small defilement of the mind. This is not the case. This is not the case. It is a ruin, ruin, ruin. The typical cause of it today and probably forever is like this relaxed state of mind that the booze and drugs, marijuana, or changed state of mind, any intoxication like tranquilizers, benzodiazepines, marijuana and alcohol induce, and then becoming addicted to this lazy state of mind, or agitated, excited state of mind, like, for example, ecstasy, cocaine, and similar things, where you feel flying, huh? Until you crash. So it's a self-destructive behavior. Any form of alcohol, drugs, dope, pills, marijuana, sniffing, overeating, excessive masturbation, and night living. Such often lifelong chemical or behavioral causes of lethargy and laziness should be eradicated, eradicated, eliminated, cut out completely. It is by no means innocent. It is outright self-destruction. Even when it's a form of a high, tall glass of red wine, classy red wine. Bullshit. It's still self-destruction. Out with it. Cut it out. Finished. Whether champagne or whatever, it is still foolish stupidity, self-destruction, other destruction, future destruction. Cut it out. As long as this cut out of booze, marijuana, and intoxicants not are achieved, then one is a zombie, a self-induced zombie, neither more nor less. Man, one is an apathetic robot drifting towards the inability to initiate any advantageous behavior. So this is the first one, I have to say, very, very dominant. We discussed it before, that dies 3 million people every year from alcohol. 3 million people. That is more than many wars together. I think even than the Second World War. Every year, every year. Now there's an epidemic of opioids in USA and all over the world. You can see morphine use, and marijuana is sold by the tons. Pot, weed, sold by the tons. Used as medicine. No way, medicine. Self-destruction. It's a bad excuse. Anyway, how to cure it? There's three tricks. Pay attention now, ladies and gentlemen, because this is important. One pays attention to this element of initiative. Initiative. Let's say you are lying on the sofa and there's the dish has to be done. And you say, you know, it's a Saturday morning and the dish has to be done because there was party yesterday and you are tired because of this boozing. This red wine dining the day before, and so you cannot take yourself together to do the dishes, raise up and do the dishes. Then once you say, what is lacking now? Is it initiative? Yes, it is initiative. Then one say, okay, I want to do it, but then one still cannot come out the sofa. Then what is lacking? This is one should pay attention to this element of launching. Launching. That's launching is right when you swing the legs out of the sofa, get up off the sofa and start going towards the kitchen to do the dishes. The last element is the element of endurance, perseverance. And one keeps on doing the task until it's finished. One doesn't leave the dish half finished. One doesn't need the meditation pillow half done with the meditation object. One doesn't leave the job in samsara before the end goal of enlightenment is achieved. One doesn't stop fighting the booze, the drug, the addictions before one is gone clean, irreversibly clean, and is clean with ease and peace. So again, one pays attention to the element of initiative, the element of launching, and the element of endurance. This one keeps on doing. One memorizes this from this video. Ah, Bhante says that three elements, three pills one has to take and redirect attention towards these three elements of initiative, launching, endurance. I'll remember them by heart. And then whenever one is overcome by laziness and lethargy, by sloth and torpor, then one thinks about, ah, what is missing now? One realizes, sloth and torpor is in me. I'm lazy. What is it missing? Is initiative? I don't even want to do what should be done. Or is it launching? I do wish to do what needs to be done, but I'm not beginning to do it yet. Or is it endurance? I'm starting to do it, but then I give up halfway. Again, the element of initiative, the element of launching like a rocket, the element of endurance, just keep going like a marathon runner. So initiative is purely mental. It's a thing, one wish to do it. Launching is both mental and bodily. The body said, the mind said to body going by doing to do the task. And enduring is what finalizes completely any already ongoing task. Noticing, being aware of this lethargy and laziness, Thina-Middha, can make it evaporate. From Madhyama Nikaya, the Buddha said, herein bhikkhus, when lethargy and laziness is present in him, the bhikkhu notes and understands there is lethargy and laziness in me. And when his lethargy and laziness is absent, he notes and understands, now there's no lethargy and laziness is in me. He indeed also understands how not yet arisen lethargy and laziness arises. And he understands how to leave behind any arisen lethargy and laziness. And he understands how left lethargy and laziness will not arise ever again in the future. Majjhima Nikaya, number 10. Again, the Buddha said, what is the feeding cause that make lethargy and laziness arise? There are boredom, apathy, tiredness, lazy stretching of the body, heavy drowsiness after two big meals, and mental sluggishness after smoking too much marijuana. Frequently giving an irrational and unwise attention to these mental states, this is the feeding cause of the arising of lethargy and laziness, and the feeding cause of worsening and deepening on already arising lethargy and laziness. Samahita Nikaya, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, 46:51. This was the feeding cause. What then is the starving cause that made lethargy and laziness cease? That's the quality of initiative. That's the quality of launching action. That's the quality of tenaciously enduring persistence. Again, initiative, launching, endurance. Frequent giving rational and wise attention, yoniso manasikara, to these three mental elements is the starving cause for the non-arising of lethargy and laziness, and the starving cause of lethargy and laziness that already has arisen. Samyutta Nikaya, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, 46:51. The supreme ideal, from Madhyama Nikaya, number 7. Before the Buddha sat down to meditate in order to attain enlightenment, he made this determination. This is the completion, the fulfillment of the 10th perfection. Of virya, one of the 10th perfections. One says to oneself, one sits down to enlightenment under a tree like this. May just this flesh and blood dry up
into a stiff frame of only bones, tendons and skin. Not a second before having achieved what can achieved by male strength, power and energy will arise from this seed. So he sit down, and you come to sit down also, and I come to sit down also one day with this do or die attitude. That's energy. That's enthusiasm, fulfilled, perfected. Do or die. Enlighten or not. Here, the commentators describe five Buddhas that went up, that decided to do this. Then they knew there was a plateau on a cliff. Then they went up there with a ladder and threw away the ladder, so they could not come down. And if they tried to climb down, they would drop down and be dead. So they went up there, and either they were enlightened or they will starve to death. Then two of them enlightened, and then they could fly. And then suggested to the three others that they could bring food to them, but the three others denied. So they died up there without being enlightened. But one of them became enlightened as a seven-year-old boy in his next rebirth, just after this rebirth. So there they had this attitude. We go up on this cliff top where there's a steep wall on either side with a long, long ladder. Then we throw away the ladder. Then we cannot go pindabat and go begging around and get food. Then it's do or die. Either we enlightened up there or we die. Two of them succeeded. Three of them did not, but enlightened in the next rebirth, immediately after. How to stimulate the mind? How does one stimulate the mind at the time it needs stimulation? If due to slowness of understanding or due to not yet having reached the happiness of tranquility, one's mind is dull, slow, then one should rouse it through reflecting on the eight objects of stirring urgency, the eight objects of samvega, of stirring up urgency. What are the eight objects? They are birth, decay, disease, death, the suffering in hell as a demon, ghost, or in the animal world, the suffering in the past, and the suffering in the future rooted in samsara, and this suffering in the present rooted in the pursuit of feud, the hunting down, going to work and maintaining a livelihood, searching for food, clothes, money, work on that entails this monotony of usually 45 to 50 to 60 years long, going to work almost every day, doing things that are basically, in many cases, meaningless. Seen from an enlightenment point of view, seen from a reaching lasting happiness point of view, if not outright absurd. Visuddhimagga, chapter 4, 63. Perceiving the suffering in impermanence. In a bhikkhu who is used to see the suffering in impermanence and who frequently reflects on this, there will be established in such acute sense of danger, adinava, in laziness, apathy, inactivity, and lethargy, just as if we're threatened by a mad murderer with a drawn sword. So the bhikkhu, he thinks, there's one with a sword standing. In this time we could say there's one with a gun. He's standing right in front of you, pointing, and he's a madman. He's one of these shooters who shoot everybody for nothing, for no good reason, because of he's a crackpot case. Insane, basically. He's standing right in front of you with a trigger, and you sit there lazy. If you think about such a man with a drawn sword or with a RR-15 semi-automatic gun right in front of you, a madman, a murderer, then there is a sense of urgency to get it done right now. Again, a story comes to mind from the Buddha's time. Somebody came and found a monk in the forest, And then they want to offer him to their robber god, and they wants to kill him. Then he said to them, please let me just stay here one more night. Then I can finish my job of enlightenment. And then he crushed his own feet, his own ankles with a big stone. So he says, now I cannot run away, so please let me live. And so they let him live the night over because he couldn't run away with his broken feet. So he sit up, meditated all night long, and early in the morning he realized Nibbana and became enlightened. And then when they waked up the robbers, he said, now I'm ready. Please do as you want. Please do as you like. And then from this peaceful, serene appearance of his, that he was not afraid of dying whatsoever. He was not afraid of their swords, their axes, their knives. Then they became so impressed with him that they became his pupil. And hereafter carried him around in a chair because of his fractured legs, self-fractured legs. That's a sense of urgency, samvega. That's a sense of danger, adinava, working its way towards enlightenment, lasting happiness. Lethargy or laziness is like an inner mental prison. Just as when a man has been forced into prison is lethargy and laziness. But later when he gets released from this inner prison, then he's safe, fearing no loss of property. At that he is good and rejoices, glad at heart. Such is like breaking out of the inner prison of lethargy and laziness. Another person has been kept in jail during a festival day and could see the other one having shows and were having so much fun, while he remained shy and mute and silent inside because his prison, because he cannot enjoy the festival himself. So is a lazy person. He sees all the good doers, all those who are well-to-do, get an education, get a job, make a house, so on, make a living, while he himself is too lazy to do. Then he's like a prison that looks out at the other one participating in a festival, a joyous festival, while he's shy, mute, because he cannot come out his prison. Similarly, this is a prison of lethargy and laziness. Another person that once had been in jail in festival day, but now he's freed and celebrating the festival on a later occasion with the other one, he looks back, he reviews his own laziness. Before, due to my own careless laziness, I was in prison on that day and could not enjoy this fine festival. Now I shall therefore be alert, and careful. Since he remains that alert and careful, no detrimental state can overcome his mind. Having fully enjoyed the festival, he exclaims, "What a fun festival! Good, advantageous is absence of lethargy and laziness." Whoever lives only to satisfy his search and urge for pleasure and beauty, unguarded in senses, immoderately indulging in eating, lazy and lethargic, inactive, dulled into apathy and dullness, such one mara sweeps away like breaking the branch of the tiny brush. Mara, he sweeps him down right into hell. Because the other one today called a hedonist that overeats and indulges in everything that can be indulged in, all kinds of sense pleasure, he's swept into the bad states. Mara, he can do with him just as he likes. Even if one should live 100 years, if lazy, slack and idle, better would it be to live just one single day striving with all ability one has. Dhammapada, verse 112. Rouse yourself, sit up, don't lie down. Resolutely train yourself to attain peace. Do not let the king of death see you lazy and thereby lead you astray and dominate you like a doll, a robot. Sutta Nipata 2. Number 10.
There will come curing lethargy and laziness. Link on whatbuddhasaid.net. It's in the drops, number 2. And it's called curing lethargy and laziness. You can go to whatbuddhasaid.net and search here for where all the given information here to overcoming this laziness and thereby break out, break free of this inner mental prison called lethargy and laziness.
Thina-Middha is given.
49 minutes and 54 seconds. Thanks for your advantageous attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. Thanks to all the Dayakas supporters and especially the regular donors who keeps the wheels running, to the meditation hall supporters and also the food givers, in particular because Wednesday here, the next Wednesday, 3 days from now, the 18th of April, I will go on my 3-weekly round to Kandy and pick up supplies. So if anybody wants to give food, then now is the time. And they can do it by going to whatbuddhasaid.net and thereby gain health, strength, and beauty merit by donating via the link called Dana via Kales. Food Dana, online food Dana, and this is the lowest link on the website whatbuddhasaid.net. And that ends the Dhamma on air. Number 98, too short of 100, on now a lovely day, New Year's Day here in Sri Lanka and in India also. And some people will come up with food to me later today, my workers. That's their habit of doing every New Year's Day. Thank you again, and may you indeed have a nice, noble, and beautiful day. Striving, remembering the element of initiative, the element of launching like a rocket, and the element of endurance. Never, never, never ever giving up developing this noble eightfold way. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Indeed. Yeah.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy. Thereby, thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution. And have a nice day.